$12.50 plus postage, so the minimum is about $25. For the first $3,000.
$12.50 for the sign?
Yeah, for everything included, but, or postage.
And then we also include $12.50 for everything before postage, and then almost $25.
Yeah.
They quarterly cost on cartage and address?
I assume the work would be much greater, both identifying what's inside the district and what's outside and drawing radius. That's why labor-wise, it's just easier to do a big citywide, because then you have the existing address data. You simply create the notice and mail it, so I assume the cost would go up if you're tailoring it to a specific radius for your district. But we didn't ask them what that would assume.
Postage costs, I believe those are bulk mail, correct?
Bulk mail, yeah.
So they're not the standard first class, significantly lower.
And bulk versus first class, that issue is also with 8 weeks or so to go. If we were to hold the public hearing on July 10th, preserve as much summer time for this to actually have a public effect. If the time it takes them to ramp up and send it out means first class, we prefer that option. As opposed to waiting to later in July or beginning in August to get the bulk rate. If there's no difference, obviously we would go with the cheaper.
Sort of tightly.
Yeah. I mean, regret that it's not April and May.
Lines are certainly a delicate topic for those that live in downtown. You only get caught on the valley floor in terms of casino or the high school noise. I'm assuming that the events at, say, the middle school wouldn't have that amperage and probably wouldn't create as much noise, but the noise travels in such an interesting way because of the valley floor that I'm a little sensitive to this issue.
Well, also, Jim, the border between the commercial and residential is frozen as well.
Correct.
Sorry.
I had that hand in front of my face again, I'm sorry for that, dude. So, I mean, there are other businesses that are, their backdoor neighbor is residential. And they would have opportunities to sue. Weird that way, but we put the hands of the fire. So is there an option such to do the public notification in the paper and to a certain online website to get the word out that the issues are?
Yes, those efforts are already done. So the opportunity was, if this were to die tonight, we would pull it from one district. We had a plan on that, but we wanted to definitely ask the question of should additional notification be on all of the e-blast things and the updates that was blocked, and take that next step of mailing. If staff were to do it, based on who is here, we don't have time to answer for two. We'd have to dedicate the need for that.
So that you clarify, Mark, the notice of paper will stay in there. This is just a public hearing. Council won't be entertaining a decision until at least July 10th. So that'll carry through.
Oh, yeah, my reference was when we were setting up the timing and the schedule. We pre-sent it to the newspaper and then it was sent out.
Actually, I have to tell you some of the resources.
Yes. So we post hard copy around town. We post hard copy around town. We put it on the website three different places. We put it through our Facebook, Twitter several times, and other, like the ROA newsletter, which is e-news, Nextdoor, Yahoo. Yeah, the Snoqualmie Ridge ROA goes to almost 4,000 people. They're a weekly e-blast. When our news goes to 900 people, and there's a lot of channels we put that public hearing notice out to.
some personnel piece would make it out in advance of that, but in July, for July.
Yeah.
And we would satisfy the notification requirements through the other channels, so we're on the line on this piece of mail to satisfy the notification requirement. It's an additional step to ensure that this amount is possible.
Correct.
Well, we're not required to have a hearing on this matter, but because of the subject matter, we want to take that as our step.
That's right.
That's an important distinction to make.
So I don't love the additional cost, but, you know, thinking about it, there's two things. It's always, you know, the example you brought up with how noise travels on the valley floor, but I think looking forward, the potential, you know, the businesses that are on Snowmall Ridge that might, you know, have this kind of entertainment in the future. You know, I think residents up there should have an opportunity to weigh in, and it is, the noise is a sensitive issue, so I think we should take the additional step to do the mail. There may not be a business, I guess what I'm saying is there may not be a business that has an outdoor venue today, but that could happen in the future. And so,
any reactions to that suggestion from the council, or first from the staff, you know? Or just as long as it's going to line bother you?
I'm okay with the grants coming.
I'm not sure that was the question, though. What is your preference on notification? Should we do a special mail on this?
We're going to go to $2,500 to get it. There was something in there for Beauty and Valley Beyond. I don't think many of those are. That goes all the way up to Prince Road and all the neighbors up above Coco Road.
Yes.
Brian?
I guess I'm okay this time. I guess, but I would prefer that we start to look at maybe if we get a quarter page ahead of the paper, maybe cheaper than this mail. Well, look at other opportunities to do notifications like that that aren't as expensive, but
do you have a time constraint?
I consider the president saying that everything is
well, and before you mentioned Cap there, another idea occurred to me, I was going to ask Bob, but I don't know if you've ever heard whatever kind of ordinance is sort of sunset on or a renewal clause. And could you just take it for a test drive this summer and see your point of view?
You never liked when I tried to do that in the past on this. But we, it's at the council discretion. At the end of the year, we could reconsider and revise it back. I mean, I don't know that you need to have a code right on that.
You trade on funding mechanisms, you've got like problems in the funding system, you've got a capital department.
I would support what Brad is saying in this particular matter, and I agree with Brian that I would not want to, I want to be very careful about this being a very expensive very quickly. So I would agree with him about not making the precedent for this one, yes, because it's such a sensitive subject. I think what we will hear a lot about is still the casino and the fisheries and things that are not pertaining to this in particular, but I do think there should be some sort of action with the fisheries. So given the time frame,
and also that feedback that the council would entertain this, and that's kind of
we'll move on to reports, Parks and Public Works Committee, Agenda Bill 17090, resolution. I'm sorry, let me back up. Is there anybody from the public that would like to comment on a part of possible future action on it?
Lenny, so I went to the Economic Development meeting Monday, and one of Heather Mendon's big concerns, which I'm not hearing anything about, was the noise limitation. Is there going to be any kind of decibel limit? My suggestion would be, if you're going to spend money on mailing flyers, thousands of homes, that you would make that decision first so people know what they're dealing with. You can download an app on your phone to determine what a decibel limit is. And I believe our police chief would appreciate it as well, because when they receive noise complaints, they can use this app on their phone or whatever method they may use to determine if the business is playing music that's too loud and disruptive to the community. It would just be a smart use of all of our resources. And regarding the newspaper, I think the actual calendar event section is very inexpensive. I was really surprised that the Twin Peaks event was not even listed in our local paper. But maybe mentioning the upcoming meeting that Mark discussed next month, it would be wise to just pop that in there, because it would be very inexpensive. And mention the decibel limit so people know when they come to this meeting what they're dealing with. Otherwise, if you're broad, people will ignore it, and our police chief will have problems down the road with noise complaints. Thank you.
Anybody else? Brad, you were at the meeting with Heather. Do you want to speak a little bit? You're telling us all the council that issue. We don't have a decibel definition.
Right. And I was actually just going to ask Bob to speak to it, because this, Heather did bring it up. Councilmember Munden did bring it up. And there was, if I remember correctly, there was going to be some research done on a subjective versus objective limit. That would go in, and so I don't know if that work has been done yet, but that discussion, we started that discussion.
Sure, and what Councilmember Munden brought up then after the meeting is that there is a set of decibel limit-based noise restrictions in Department of Ecology regulations and a state statute that says if you're going to adopt something more stringent than that, then you need to obtain ecology approval. So there's a whole separate process associated with that. And so her, I don't want to put words in her mouth, but I think my sense from that conversation was she was less interested in going down that road, given that there would be this kind of potential additional process to go with. Other considerations about using a decibel-based approach is that it tends to be it's a weighted average over time, and so if you have noise that changes or spikes, you have to then take a different approach to that. And it's, if you don't have police who are there the entire time to capture that, then they're showing up. The decibel level may be different at one point than it is at another point. So it's complicated. It's a short answer.
I think it's during the initial issue with dirt fish. And because of the way sound travels and the way the valley is formed, we never came up with a really good mechanism to set a particular decimal level. I can tell you, on my back deck, I can hear some concerts perfectly clearly from the casino. My next door neighbor can't, because of just how sound travels. So we did have a large discussion around the idea of a decimal limit, and it was kind of inconclusive at that time. I'm looking at the mayor and Bob.
Everybody's going to be angry no matter what.
I don't
out that there was a decibel option as well. The understanding more what Mr. Sturbeck's saying might be just a very complicated process as opposed to just how the ordinance is now. We have decibel reading. I don't remember what it is. When we had concerts in Marymore Park, which was outside the city, we would, if we got noise complaints, we would essentially have an officer have a decibel reader go up to the complainant's property line, point it towards Marymore Park, and if it was a violation of that meter reading, then we would contact Marymore and tell them to turn the meter down. Basically, how it worked.
You got to underneath the King County ordinance, and they can have a decibel at the property line.
This was a Redmond municipal code, so I'm not sure.
So here's my we looked at the county, and they did have a decibel meter, and we're looking at their budget. But again, it's noisy depending on where you measure.
Right. Yeah, I look at this, and you know, there's a question of scale, right? The concerts, the events that have taken place at Marymore Park are of a much grander scale than what we're talking about of you know, what would happen within the city of St. Paul. And in the future, that could change, but today we're talking about it would almost be overkill to go down that road to regulate the noise of some, you know, entertainment that's taking place or a business establishment versus a concert for 5,000 people or something like that.
Well, I think by extending it to 11 o'clock, I mean, that's not the wee hours of the morning when, you know, a same person is trying to sleep. That's still considered kind of a early hour for a weekend or that type of event. So I think perhaps correct. I'm more worried about the noise from the casino than I am these businesses.
Do go down the decibel route, and you then have to get the equipment to measure that. I had the apple here, it's a fun little toy, but I wouldn't want to take it to court. So you would need equipment, and I would hate to have enforcement held up while somebody goes running the decibel. I think the police force will know it, they'll know it when they see it, they'll know it when they hear it. So we have to put the ordinance along those lines.
Do we have any noise complaints now?
Any specific about anything?
In general.
Not really. I mean, they're random. They could be residential ones where they're, you know, kids are playing loud music in the garage or something like that. But for the most part, we don't get a lot of noise complaints. They could be loud mufflers of cars versus any kind of issue of a business stick. I mean, we've had maybe one or two noise complaints from downtown businesses, but for the most part, we don't think people
house alarms that go off at 1:30 at night.
Public Works Committee, Senate Bill 17090, Resolution 1383, adopting a 6-year transportation improvement plan for STIP for the period 2018 through 2023.
State law requires each city develop a local 6-year transportation improvement plan and that it be annually updated, RCW 3577010. It also requires projects to be included in the STIP in order for the cities to compete for transportation funding grants from both federal and state sources. Move to approve Resolution 1393, adopting a 6-year transportation improvement program STIP for the period of 2018 through 2023. May I have a second?
A motion and second for Agenda Bill 17090. That's a state by Councilor Paul. Is there any discussion?
Well, I have a question and then a comment. My question is, the Newton Street extension from Railroad to 384 has a time limit on it, and can follow up on it. It's not.
That's not something I know. I know there's a time limit on it, but I don't know the specifics. Maybe Foster might guess, but I think it's primarily tied to the bringing the conveyance of the property to extend this rate.
Yeah, I don't know the number offhand. I recall vaguely that there is something, but I think right now.
Could somebody just offline? I just what the year is, and does the work need to be completed by then or started by then?
If I recall if I recall the numbers that are currently proposed would fall underneath both of those, but I will verify that.
That'd be great.
Okay.
And then my comment is, and I'm sorry I don't have the number on here, but the 384th Meadowbrook North Bendway, I believe we have it tagged as a roundabout, but that intersection is actually outside of, city limits. But it's something that I asked to be added to quite some time ago because that is a major gateway for downtown. It's an extremely, can be dangerous intersection, as a couple of folks found out recently. We had a very severe T-bone of a car in that intersection. So I just mentioned it to council, I mentioned it to the administration, it would be good to put some pressure on King County, which I know probably won't go anywhere because of their stance on rural roads, quote unquote. But also, maybe we can discuss with the tribe and get some irrigation and put money in that intersection since a lot of the traffic goes to
Sula.
Up by the old hospital, so up in this intersection where you have that funky arterial turn where you can come downtown without stopping and everybody goes through that stop sign, and then it's a fairly dangerous intersection to try to turn left and onto North Bendway. So just so you're all aware of it, and we just need to keep pressure on this one.
So we probably don't have jurisdiction in the intersection, but our city limits come right up to that, don't they?
Yes, they do. They are on, my understanding is it's on the side of the road. The road is not actually, and so it is kind of that peninsula where the old hospital is, and then back down Meadowbrook. So that actual intersection is a key down.
But
Wolfsville
County didn't want to change
the parking
strip.
Well, that would be a nice conversation to have with try the next time we talk to them, and invite Kathy Lander to come to those meetings.
That's a project recommendation.
What's that?
I think it's good. That's a project recommendation. I'm just going to submit to that.
Are you requesting that we take this back to the committee and add that into the priority list?
No.
Or are you suggesting we just add it to the list tonight?
It's on the list.
Oh, okay.
And I'm sorry I don't have a number on it, but it is listed there, but I just wanted to bring everybody's attention to I believe it's listed with no funding source. Primarily, we had it on there just to provide somebody with visibility on that, knowing the county was probably not going to do anything about it. So do you have it in front of you?
I can get it back again. I do. It is, there are 15 projects identified on the SIP, and this is number 12.
So there is a sort of prioritization of those numbers.
Correct, there are, and that's provided also to the state for the funding. And then number one on the list is the Kimmelquick Creek Bridges, and it goes on from there. So.
Can you list the first two in my packet, as Fuzzy mentioned, don't have a priority listed? Is that? I don't.
No, if you look at actually the priority 2018-23, the last attachment there,
Jimmy, in the bottom document,
it actually has the priorities listed.
Okay, I was looking at the STIP projects.
correct, I think we need to make a couple edits to that before we submit that to the state, because I noticed also looking at it today, we are missing the priority numbers on a few of those, and I think that's partly because they were changed. But the table, the larger table that I think Jimmy is bringing up, those are the priorities that are going to be included in that. We'll do one more edit of those documents.
Increase the font size.
The descriptions are fairly lengthy, so it's like.
Well, and out of committee, we made no changes to the projects or the descriptions. We really had discussion on the prior.
Just one other comment, council may recall that the Stoke Poly Tribe does have expansion plans for the former hospital site, which currently is located in the city. And so the city, were that to remain the case, the city would have authority to require improvements to that intersection as part of any redevelopment. So if the tribe were to apply for and get federal approval to place that property on federal trust, then the city would lose the ability to require that. But that, as they stand right now, that could be a logical time for those improvements as part of the redevelopment.
Is there a timeline on that redevelopment?
Not that we're aware of. We don't know the potential uses or scope or scale. Those details are not shared.
And I just wanted to add on the third priority item up there, the pedestrian signals, and some comments to me about that. For one, is those of you were one of the few around here in the day that you remember that the SPI was triggered to put that from Business Park 2 into a residential community with a big Fisher Peak Park. And by virtue of that, the traffic counts dropped the metrics. So what was in the original plan where they were required to do a traffic signal became impactful to Business Park in the neighborhood. When the traffic counts dropped, the developer argued that there weren't much metrics in using the municipal uniform traffic control device standards to justify them paying full cost. They provided a proportional share, which is only for a quarter of what it would take to do a full signalization. If there is for future development, if of course there's actually share change, there would be an opportunity to mitigate against that development for full improvement there. However, I don't think we're complying with the delays that have already been caused. We've made at least two runs trying to get grants to the State Transportation Improvement Board for a full signalization to match that those dollars we have from the developer. But so we're kind of laughed out of the room and said, you look at it. The accident numbers and the traffic data, it didn't stand a chance. And that's caused delays, and we've heard the concerns from that neighborhood about those issues. So it's a big improvement.
Regarding the traffic warrants that you referred to that were done by the developer, those were over 11 years old. So we've seen quite a bit of growth in Stoke Poly since then, as well as the community park being expanded into this popular community park in the city for children. Yet, I just wanted to add that the traffic survey that was done about 3 years ago that I've asked for about at least 12 times or more, I'm still waiting to get a copy on. We discussed it. Dan Marcinko is going to email me a copy of the full traffic survey based on last Monday's meeting. A week ago, I still have not received it. The traffic survey was done on a snowy February day when school was out of session. And the traffic warrants that residents, I believe it was 6 and 8, felt that the city should have considered, the city did not want to consider and told the traffic surveying company not to do. So I'm just letting you know that as a resident and other residents that live in the area, all we know is that we saw two teenagers T-bone each other January 2016 at this intersection. It's dark in the morning. Children are crossing the parkway to touch the middle school bus on the other side, and regardless of old traffic warrants or more current traffic warrants that were not done at the appropriate time of year, something needs to be done about this. And I would like to suggest that if you are going to go ahead with this dangerous plan, which I believe is creating a false sense of security, and it's going to, you know, people will push a button like Fuzzy said and think they're safe and they won't notice a 10,000-pound logging truck flying down the parkway going 60, or the dirt tracks that I have to dodge every day just to get in and out of my neighborhood. So if you want to take that chance, I would highly suggest that you invest the $14,000 extra. We know you're paying $3 million to repave the parkway. $14,000 to at least try to slow people down a little bit. You know, they're coming down the parkway, it's a downward slope. The primroses get high, you can't see. It's dark in the morning. It's very, very dangerous. And I still do not understand why the city won't listen to residents that fight this every day. But that would be my suggestion regarding Fisher. And again, backing up Fuzzy, I wish the council would reconsider the traffic signal, which is ultimately what we need. And all of the underground infrastructure was put in by the developer plus $204,000. And I saw bids for $325,000 to finish the job. So it was only going to cost an extra $104,000. But the city instead changed the plans, moved. Now the hot crosswalk will be on the opposite upward slope of the parkway. The underground infrastructure that's under the street can't be used. We have to dig all new underground infrastructure. We hired $60,000 worth of outside engineering firms to do the plans because we could not do it in-house. And I'm sorry the money was wasted, and I'm sorry this is happening. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who would like to comment on this?
Good evening, Council. Good evening, Mayor. This might be